Hello, Saylorville women. I'm Lindsay Holan, and I am excited to start something new today in women's ministry that I hope will continue on and happen on a somewhat regular basis. And that is to get to sit down and chat with a woman who is on the mission field as a full-time missionary, whether sent by Saylorville or a missionary that Saylorville supports. And a reason why I wanted to do this was because last September, I took my first ever mission trip in my life to Berlin, Germany. And while I was there, God taught me so many things, but one of the things that he did was to open my eyes to how culture really impacts our daily lives as Christians, our daily walk, as well as what the culture in the church is. We all have culture that surrounds us every day that we're usually not aware of unless we step into another culture and see with our own eyes what are some of the things that other women in other cultures experience. And so what I want to do is to sit down with women who are on the mission field and kind of get a glimpse into what daily life is like for them and what they face as women in that particular culture on the mission field serving the Lord for his glory. And so as a church who highly values missions, I would like for us as Saylorville women to get the experience to have our eyes opened to what women all across the world are experiencing in their culture and how that impacts their faith and maybe how that culture impacts why we have missionaries there. And so today I am honored to sit down with our very first missionary woman, and that is Bev Leonard. And so I am just going to have a conversation with her about what life is like in Brazil and how God is using her there. And I'm just really excited to hear how God uses you on the mission field. And so Bev, can you just share with us quickly, just how long have you been on the mission field in Brazil and any information that you feel we should know right off the bat?
We have been on the mission field since August 14th of 1990. So that's almost 30 years.
Wow.
It'll be 30 years in August. So, and it has been an amazing experience for me, for my husband. We've had our ups and downs, but it has been, for the most part, an awesome experience.
Wow. 30 years. So you must have gone when you were like 10 or something.
Right, for sure.
Okay, so there in Brazil, and I know you have moved around some over your 30 years, but right now, and when you go back, how would you describe the neighbors and the community and the people that live in your community there in Brazil?
Okay, Brazilians, Lindsay, are, there's some similarities between us and between them, but they're a very like fun-loving people. They love a party, and it's not uncommon at all to see our neighbors having a bunch of people over for sometimes no reason at all. they'll just have a party. But whenever there's a holiday, they for sure get together and just have a good time. And John and I counted one time, there were 156 days in the year that everybody took off for one reason or another.
Wow.
Like, that's including Saturday and Sundays.
Okay.
But like if they have, for example, if Christmas would fall on Thursday, then they automatically take off Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Not even Christmas, let's see. Some other holiday, just any other holiday. It depends on when it happens. If it happens on a Thursday, then they take a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and sometimes Monday. They
wow.
love to have a good time. And the difference between them and us is that they think we're more like cold and not as, you know, not as fun loving. And we're very like scheduled and focused, and we got to get this done. We're always busy, you know. And they're like, don't worry about it. If it doesn't get done today, it'll get done tomorrow, you know, that's that sort of thing. So that's probably the biggest difference between our neighbors and us.
Okay.
As far as them being open to the gospel, they're amazing. They, like, if you will invite them to church, they usually accept. They'll usually say, you'll say, can you come to church with me for, you know, whenever? And they usually accept. They usually say, sure, I'll, you know, because they think that you'll be hurt. It'll hurt your feelings if they say,
okay,
you know, if they say, no, I'm not coming or whatever.
Okay.
So they're really kind-hearted and really soft-hearted. And they, the fact that they love a party and that they are, you know, willing to come to whatever. We try to have special events in our church to involve them. And just, and a lot of times they do accept. If it's a special event, they'll accept and they come. And it just makes them more open to the gospel. And I love it. I love the culture down there. It's amazing.
So when you say that they will accept because they don't want to hurt your feelings, do you feel you need to reciprocate that? If you do, you get invited to other people's homes or other kinds of celebrations, whether
sure.
a holiday or anything, is that the same for you and John that you feel you need to accept?
Yes.
Okay.
We do. In fact, the birthdays are a big thing down there. And a lot of times they end up being like what would you say, a party that unsaved people would, you know, the drinking and the just all the wild party type thing.
Okay.
I don't know how else to say it. But we always, it's, well, not always, but we rarely turn them down.
Okay.
Because we want to reach them for the gospel. And and that's our goal, obviously, of being there. And so, yeah, we usually go early.
Okay.
You know, we go early, always give them a nice present. And, yeah, we do that. That's a good question.
So you kind of have a plan in place, especially if you're going to, and you know you're going to be amongst a lot of unbelievers.
Yes.
You kind of have a plan in place, maybe to set yourself up for being the best Christ-like representatives and to keep yourselves, you know, out of the...
As an example,
That's
true. In fact, we have, John has had opportunities to, this just came to my mind, to... say a word at a birthday party, because they'll gather together. And if he says, can I say a prayer or can I read a scripture, something about, you know, and they'll let him sometimes.
Wow.
So it's amazing. It's that's just Brazilians. They're amazing people.
Okay.
We love
them. Okay. That's really neat. Is there anything in the community, or in Brazil in general, that is highly valued in the community, that maybe, whether that's family, sports, you know, materialistic things, what kind of things are most valued, would you say?
Family is highly valued down there, probably more than, you know, I'm pretty sure more than here. They do, like, there are a lot of couples who will live together, not be married. It's very common. I mean, in our church, it's just a very common thing. But they do value, like, families getting together and, like, taking care of their elderly. They would never think of you know, putting them, well,
it,
sometimes it happens that they need to go to a home, but for the most part, they take good care of them, you know, and they're like, oh, my mom, I would never do that, you know, so they do have a very special family bond. The other sports, soccer. Soccer is huge in Brazil, and I've always loved sports, and so I enjoy that culture thing. Like during the World Cup, they have, you know, we would usually have people in our home, the kids of the neighborhood or whatever, And we would, you know, yell at the TV and scream around and have things to eat and stuff, and use it as a way to build relationships. It's really awesome.
Now, can you give us just a little glimpse into what your home looks like, so that we can visualize?
Sure. Our home right now, we're a little bit different now than what we were all of our lives. All of our lives, we lived right where we were ministering, right amongst all the people that we were ministering to. Our ministry has changed, and therefore we have different ones that are kind of spread out. So we now live in a community that's a little bit more, it's out of the city, it's more in the country. And it's really a very nice community. It's a very nice place to live. We have our neighbors, a lot of them are business people. Mm. And so we don't live like on the Indian village, in the Indian village. And we don't live in San Pedro where we minister, but because of the distance, we have to live somewhere kind of in between, and that's where we are.
Okay.
We have the safety issue too. There's, you know, where we were before, we ended up paying a security and paying for dogs and all kinds of things, and it was just easier for us to move into a community where there was security and everything. So it's a little bit different now.
Yeah. But may I ask what kind of security issues you were facing that you would need to hire or pay for security or dogs?
Right. Okay. So obviously John was shot when this was back in 2005. And so it's a different world down there when it comes to how things are handled, like crimes, for example. It's the wild, wild west, pretty much. And so, but another issue, the issue that we, you know, that affects us most is thievery. They will break into your house and, you know, take things. It's kind of a part of the culture, you know. Even I've gotten used to it. And it's something, but it's not really hard to deal with if you just have a security in place.
Yeah.
It's fine. It usually works out great. But where we were living before, we've always paid a night watchman, we've always paid we've always had dogs, and you have to feed them, you have to take them to the vet, and you end up spending a lot. And so then it was easier just to go to a community where we pay a security and they take care of all of that for us. Plus we're getting older, no kids around to run and do this and that, you know.
Yeah.
So but we're still able to reach out. There's so many opportunities. A lot of our neighbors are interested in learning English because they're like businessmen and women. And so I've had the opportunity to trade English for Portuguese, you know, because they correct my Portuguese, I correct their English. And we get to know each other and build relationships that way. That has been amazing. Something I've never been able to do, because we've always worked with like the common people, which we still do as well, but it's been neat to have that that other group of people to work with. It's been really, really awesome.
Yeah, that's really neat. So how do you, Bev, what are some specific ways that you minister to women in Brazil?
Okay, it's a little the flavor of our women's ministry where we are, it's a little bit different up north, but for the most part in Brazil, our circle of churches have a little bit, it's definitely different than how it is here at Saylorville with you ladies. But what they like to do is get a group of ladies together and have once a month get together as ladies mm-hmm. and have a program, you know, like mm-hmm. singing and a devotional just for ladies, yeah. you know, and it is an awesome time. And mm-hmm. so when we went back in 2015, I'm like, this is one of my goals. I want to get this. We are ready for this in mm-hmm. this church plant. And thankfully, we were able to do that. What they do is they elect a president and a vice president and a treasurer. And then mm-hmm. they have their little offering, you know, that they, every time we meet once a month, they all, just what they can, you know, yeah. everybody just, we sing a song and then they take an offering up and put it in the Bible. It's just, you know, it's really a precious time. And anyway, I wanted to get that. I really wanted to get that established. And it, thankfully, I'm so grateful that they were able to do that. And, you know, I was telling you, Lindsay, that even during this time of the virus, they haven't been meeting, but they are reaching out mm. to each other, and they're reaching out to the unsaved. They've continued active. You know, I told mm. you about the shower that yeah. they did for Marcy Laney. She's a young Christian, and she has two little boys, and then she's going to have a little girl, and they're all excited. Oh. You know, everybody's just all excited.
Now, will you share what they did?
Yeah,
it was okay. just such a fun idea.
Yeah, they were not going to just let it go because they wanted to have a shower for mm. it, the church, you know. So they put their masks on, two ladies put their masks on, and they got a car. Not all the ladies drive. A lot of them don't have cars, and a lot of them don't drive, but they... One of the ladies that has a car, they loaded up the back of the car with beautifully wrapped presents. I mean, Brazilians are really good at that. Hmm. And they didn't just do that. They decorated the inside of the back of the car so that when she opened it, when Marcy Laney opened it, it was a total surprise to her. When she opened it, then she saw everything there.
Oh,
and she was
wow.
like, it was amazing. I wasn't there at the time, yeah. but they sent me pictures of it. So I could just picture, I'm like, yes, they're still being strong in yes. the Lord and reaching out to each other. And since she's a young Christian, okay. she's pretty young. You know, she was baptized. She and her husband, I think it was in September, right before we came back.
Yeah.
So.
And that's just one way that discipleship can look among women, is to serve each other and sacrifice
right.
and just build each other up. And I'm sure it was such an encouragement to her as a young believer. And just sometimes we have to get creative with discipleship. And so
right.
that's an amazing story.
Mm-hmm.
I love that.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some cultural barriers that over your 30 years that maybe you have had to overcome? I know there's a lot of similarities. Are there any cultural barriers that were harder for you to overcome than others?
Yeah, there probably were some. But the main one for me was the language because, and that's kind of a, you know, expected one, but it was a big one for me. When we went down in 90, I was expecting Jonna, our third, and I knew she was going to be born 8 months after we got there. So I wanted to try to get as much of the language, you know, out of the way as I could, because I had two little boys, Josh and Jared, were older, but they were, you know, pretty young.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just, I knew it was going to get pretty crazy after she was born. So I tried to get that out of the way. And then I remember, though, after 2 years, the ladies asked me to give my testimony, and I was like, oh. You know, in Portuguese.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I should know this, you know. I should be able to just, you know, do it easily. But I struggled with it, and it was a humiliating, you know, experience for me. But then I realized that the Lord just kind of spoke to me and said, Bev, it's a pride issue.
Mm.
Because I wasn't talking like I should. And I knew that in order to learn, I had to talk. Yeah. I had to make mistakes mm-hmm. in front of everybody, and maybe they would laugh at me. Well, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
You know, you have to get laughed at. You have to humble yourself. And the Lord just kind of said, Bev, you're going to have to get rid of this pride and just start talking. So, and I kind of, you know, had to have a little time with him. And also, there was one thing in the language that I kept messing up on. It was just every time. And I couldn't get it through my head. I could not figure it out. So one night I said, I'm going to stay up till whatever time it is, and I'm going to figure this out. And so I did. I stayed up till, I don't know, it was like 1 or 2 in the morning. I forget. It was late, but I finally got it in my head. And after that, then, that principle that I learned helped me to apply to everything else. I kind of went off on the language, but that was a huge barrier. John grew up in Brazil.
Yeah.
And so he was off, you know, he was preaching the first Sunday we got there and giving his testimony, teaching Sunday school, whatever they asked him to do, you know, and he could go downtown and do whatever and, you know, shop or whatever. And so that was hard for me because he was off, you know, just doing whatever, which he had to be.
Yeah.
He had to be, you know, busy. But then I was at home with the kids. I couldn't talk. And
feeling, you know, a little left behind.
Yes, most definitely.
How long would you say it took for you to really finally feel comfortable?
Comfortable? Yeah, I still make mistakes. But no, I would say, It was shortly after that 2 year mark. It was probably in my third, fourth year that I started being able to express, you know, pretty well what I was trying to get across. So
a test in patience amongst raising young kids and being in a new culture and I'm sure a bit of culture shock to some extent.
Yes. It was a lot different. Our lives were a lot different. It was just in our first home, we lived like our wall was the neighbor's wall was the neighbor's wall, and it was just like a row houses, you know, and so you could hear everything from everybody, and it was totally different. But you know, I told the Lord years ago, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll do what you want me to do. And I'm so thankful I did that.
Yeah.
Because there were times when I thought,
not
sure I'm going to make it. But
yeah,
God was very good.
And if had everything been easy from the beginning, you'd have missed out on the growth.
Exactly.
And the lessons.
Exactly.
Which is why we shouldn't always fear change and fear challenges, because that's where the growth is.
That's so true.
And
so
I often think, you know, with a roller coaster, sometimes you have to get the momentum of going down to be able to make it up the hill.
Amen.
And so I'm sure that was somewhat the case.
Very true.
With you. But so culturally, what are some of the differences there in Brazil versus here in America? And what are some of the, you've said some of the similarities and some of the differences. Are there any other, like, just major differences culturally between Brazil and here?
I was trying to think. For women, there was up north, down south where we are now, we're near the big city of São Paulo. So there's not a lot of difference, like, for women down south.
Yeah.
It's very similar. Up north, one thing that I remembered is that John had to have a work truck. He's just Mr. Construction, you know, and a go-getter. And so he had to have a work truck. But he found out that if he would drive that truck downtown, he couldn't park it. So because there was no room. It's just the parking lots are just real small. So anyway, I would end up driving the truck sometimes because that would be my extra vehicle. And I would always get pointed at, like, look at her, you know, because there's a lady driving. Because it's not really very common for a a lady to drive a car, as I said.
Oh, okay.
Well, down south, it's much more common. But up north, there's a lot of the ladies in our church that okay. that did not have driver's license, didn't drive. So it was really something. But they didn't say it in a negative way.
Yeah.
You know, it was more like an amazement thing, like, wow, there's a lady that's driving this big truck, you know. And to me, it was, you know, I grew up on a farm
yeah.
and, you know, in Kansas, so it was not a big thing. But so I would say there was a little bit of that man-woman separation
okay.
type thing, you know.
Of more women should do this and not
yes,
do this.
Yes.
Maybe how it was for us, I don't know,
exactly.
50 years ago.
Exactly. That is, there was much more of okay. that up north. But I was sensitive to it. I'm like, this is the way it is here, you know, Bev, don't try, you know,
yeah.
and I tried to be respectful and not, even though I wanted the women to, you know, have their place at least, especially in the church, you know, and we were able to do quite a bit, a
yeah.
lot with the
yeah.
ladies. It was amazing. But I was aware of it, so I didn't want to just like, in your face, you know.
Yeah, come in
thing.
And I'm going to change the culture
yeah,
or
you know,
defy it. Or,
yeah, you
yeah.
can't do that
yeah.
either, so.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, but yeah, there was much more up north. I did notice it. I can say that I did notice more of that traditional type thing.
Okay. It's always just fascinating to hear the differences.
Yeah.
So, even though, so this is kind of, I feel like I'm kind of asking the same questions, but even though you're a team with John, you guys serve together as one. What are some of the unique challenges that you have faced as a woman on the mission field that might be different than what John has faced on the mission field?
Yeah, I imagine it's probably about what I have been saying. It's there's not a whole lot, and like I said, it's gotten way better.
Mm-hmm.
There is one difference down south, and that is, and I forgot to mention it, with the Guarani ladies, they are much more traditional. The men are like the hunters and the fishermen, and the ladies do absolutely everything else.
Mm.
I mean, they have to dress the, you know,
okay.
the meat or whatever, and they have to build the fire and take care of all the kids and bathe the kids and do everything,
mm.
you know. And now that the government is giving them checks,
oh.
sometimes the men will go out and they will spend mm. everything on, you know, alcohol or bad living or whatever, and leave the women totally mm. to fend for themselves and their children. It's really, really sad. That's something I forgot to mention. But yeah, they're... As a woman, as you know, in the ministry, like kind of like what I told you, I have had to watch it a little bit, you know, just not be real forward with the way and try to be respectful to the men. But really down south, we have basically almost total freedom to do ministry how we want to do it, and
okay.
it's been really amazing. I've enjoyed it a lot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So are there certain perceptions that Brazilians have of Americans? Is there kind of a, you know, a stereotype or some that are true that they view as Americans because of the cultural difference?
Yes.
Or lack of, or maybe just ignorance too, of not really fully understanding each other.
Yeah. Americans, for the most part, the Brazilians have a good view of Americans as a whole. I remember during 9/11, I remember one time after 9/11 happened. Was that 2001. There was some anti-American feelings going around, some groups that were trying to rise up. In fact, when we went downtown, we saw, you know how they do the graffiti thing,
mm.
and it said "Death to America." Mm. There were some groups like that were starting to rise up. So That's the only time in our ministry that I remember that they were, you know, a little bit more anti-American. And the embassy always keeps in touch with us, and they're like, you know, just play it cool. And we never mention, like, politically, you know, political things or anything. We try to stay uninvolved in that. But for the most part, they do think that Americans are frío, which means cold, kind of, because we're more cut and dry.
Okay.
You know, like, they'll call you up, and if they want you to pay them, for example, for something, you know, that you're owing them, then they'll talk about the weather, they'll talk about the I don't know what, and I don't know, you know, because they think it's impolite to say...
Get to the point.
Yeah, to get the point.
Okay.
So they'll just, like, you know, talk about a lot of things, and then they'll finally get around to what... Plus, they have more time, you know, like I said. Americans are like, okay, let's get this done now. And they're just, like, much more relaxed. It's like, it'll get done someday, you know.
Yeah. So. Are their work days structured a lot different where we're, you know, 8 to 5 and every hour is accounted for and punch the clock, or is it more relaxed?
Yeah, depending on the job, but they do have, like, the factories are all that way. You punch in and, you know, and it's fairly similar, and they actually, some of the companies work until noon on Saturdays as well. So, but a lot of them are going to 12-hour days every other day, which I think some people are doing here. I'm not sure if that's true or not, but a lot of them, for example, my daughter-in-law, Mary Josh, my oldest son, she's a nurse, and that's the way she does it. She works from, you know, every other day for a 12-hour day.
Okay.
And it's pretty structured for the most part, but they, you know, the days off thing that I mentioned at the beginning, they will just, oh, well, you know, this is a special day, so we won't be going to work today, you know.
They kind of protect their days off, would you say, instead of packing them full of whatever I need to get this done, or packing them full of, you know, whatever it is. Okay, so they just kind of...
That's very true,
them.
Lindsay, like we do, you know, making our list and say we've got to get, you know, this done on our day off. Very true.
So when you are here in America, like you are now, what do you miss most about Brazil?
Okay, I made a list, but it's, I'll just say it off the top of my head, because I made an actual list this time.
Okay.
I wrote it down because I always forget. People say, well, what do you miss? You know, you said what I miss about Brazil, right? Not when I'm
like
in Brazil.
Like right now, what do you miss about Brazil?
Right, right.
And then after that, you can tell us what you miss about America when you're in Brazil.
That's what I wrote down this time. I remember that. I was just thinking the other day how I miss singing in Portuguese.
Oh.
I love singing in Portuguese. And of course, I love congregational singing, so I miss that too, because we haven't had it here, so everyone's missing it.
Yeah.
But I heard, you know, I've been trying to listen to groups singing in Brazil, just the Portuguese, and it's uplifted my spirit so much. Mm. I really miss hearing them. They sing, you know, it's really hard to describe. My kids could probably do it better, but they like sing with their entire being, you know. They're very expressive, which I mean, Saylorville does an awesome job of that too, but they're just even the congregation, you know, no one just kind of mutters or anything, you know. They're like
maybe not
all there,
so
you know?
Worried about what the people around us think about
right they're just, you know, they're very expressive, and and that is so exciting to me when they're singing, you know, songs of praise to the Lord. I miss that a lot. Let's see, there were a couple other things that I thought of. The freedom that we have, like, you'll see groups music groups, they'll just, you know, there'll be a, they call it what's a plaza, which is an open area downtown, you know, plaza or something. I don't know what they call it here, but anyway, they have quite a few of them. And even downtown São Paulo, they'll just set up their, you know, their music and start singing, you know, evangelistic, and somebody will preach. And we do open air meetings, you know, down there. We do meetings in homes, and people hear it, you know, all the time. And it's not that, you know, everything's kind of shut in, and, you know, and like when we do visitation, we go, you know, you go on the streets and there's lots of people. You don't have to, like, go into a house or whatever. I mean, you can just, when we go to invite people to an event or give out tracts or whatever we're doing at the time, we just go on the street, basically, because a lot of people don't have cars. They use public transportation. Mm. So especially the best times are to go are when, yeah, that's another thing is the school systems. They have four, they meet four times. They have the morning school, which is usually younger, and then like the middle school is in the afternoon, and then the older kids are from must be 6 to 10. It's 4 hours each anyway. So if you go during that break when they're doing the transition, you can see a ton of people. You can see every age, you know, and so that's amazing to be able to reach a lot of people, you know, and reach into their hearts. And it's just, it's very, I would say it's easier to minister in Brazil. There's and tons of opportunities, just tons.
Yeah. Do you find that they are just more reliant on each other? Less independent as like Americans. Everybody's got their plot of land and things are more spread out, unless you're in a, you know, a big city and in apartments and you're walking everywhere. But in Des Moines or Ankeny, you're driving everywhere, you're in your own car, you're in your own house with your own yard. So do you think that plays a part in any of that? Less
by all
dependence.
Means, yes, they are much more dependent on each other, which is amazing because, you know, their friendships are closer. Yeah. They rely on each other much more, and it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. I can see how that too would be if you give an invitation, how it might be considered rude not to accept.
Right. So you're kind of getting a picture of the culture. I'm glad.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense, I guess. You're right.
Yeah, you're doing a really good job of describing. I mean, I'm able to picture it in my mind, and it's
that's good.
Make me really want to come down and,
yay,
and see
come.
You, which would be really neat. Okay, so when you're in Brazil, what do you miss most about America?
Okay, yes. I finally made a list this time because I always forget. People always ask me, I always forget. So I get to the airport last October 31st or whatever it was when we got here, and it was cold, and I go into the public restroom and there's hot tap water. Yay!
Oh, okay.
They do have heated tap water sometimes.
Okay.
It's just a crazy thing that I that was one thing that I remembered this time was amazing.
Okay.
Was I loved that. And you know, I'm just gonna mention a bunch of just things that came up. Let me think. Oh, the next thing was the soft chairs. They, you know, like the padded pews, and you know, we have the board pew thing, which is fine. I mean, we
it's a place
don't
to
mind
sit.
At all. It's a place to sit, and we're very happy. But you know, the soft, like when I crawled into the van the first time, we have, you know, our old 2000 van, but it, I mean, I just like melted into the seat. It's like, oh, this is so comfortable. And then we went to the supermarket and all the variety of things and, you know, just so many choices of everything.
Now down there, are you having to go several different places?
Sometimes,
Walmart or, you know, even in our grocery stores, you can buy hair stuff and makeup. And are you having to go several different places down in Brazil?
Not so much now.
Okay.
When we were in the north, we would have to go to all different kinds of stores. But then even after we moved out of Shuazedo and went over to Maceo, which is where our kids were basically raised, they started having like, it would be like a Walmart, you know, okay. They started getting those types of things. And that was amazing too. But yeah, I was gonna say something else about the, what else I missed about America, but I think that was it for now.
Okay.
It might come to me later.
Just speak up when it does.
Okay.
What is one of the most encouraging things that someone has done for you while you were on the mission field?
Okay. One of my colleagues, a fellow missionary lady, came to visit me on a day when I've often told her, I'm on the mission field today because of you, which is not true. The Lord would have kept me on. But she was used greatly in my life at a time when I was feeling really lonely. And she just came at the right time. Mm-hmm. You know, she came for a visit. I don't even remember. She might have brought me some food or something. I don't remember. I just know that she was there. And that was an amazing thing. She was a fellow American missionary. And the other thing was a church. It was a ladies group in Ohio. Jonna was, like I said, I was expecting Jonna when I went down to Brazil. And so I had her on the mission field. That was a huge different experience. But they did a shower, a baby shower, you know, just with themselves. And then they brought presents. They brought like these cute little dresses and disposable diapers, just a bunch of, you know, really neat things. And they took pictures of them. They had a cake, you know, that said congratulations and had Jonna's name and stuff like that. And then they took pictures and they packaged up all the presents and sent them to us, which was amazing. The only thing, Lindsay, was that package did not arrive.
It never did?
Never arrived.
Oh, no.
And so we were terribly embarrassed about it. So it either got lost in the mail or something. So it was really hard. But what a special thing to do, you know, those ladies. And then to have that happen was kind of heartbreaking. But it was just so sweet, something that they did. They thought, you know, it was a young missionary on the field, and they're like, let's get together and, you know, support them. So it was really special. Even if it didn't come, it's like, it's just things. So, you know, I know they were very disappointed. But it was amazing what they did. And then I can't be asked this question without mentioning Saylorville Church. Some of you remember in 2005, John was injured. And I really have no words to thank Saylorville for what they did for us at that time. I think the hardest thing for me was I homeschooled the kids, you know. Mm-hmm. And the hardest thing for me was probably letting go of my kids. I remember being in the hospital and I thought, you know, my kids, what am I going to do with them? You know, I've had them right here, you know, with me all the time. So that was really hard. But even though they didn't have their own family, they did have a church family here that welcomed them with open arms. And I don't want to mention names too much. I mean, people helped us. Pastor Pat was and Marilyn were here, of course, and they were wonderful. And Pastor Pat kept throwing scripture at me. Bev, just say this, you know. And I love that he was pointing me, you know, to Christ during that time. That was amazing. But Yeah, there's people that helped us buy a house, you know, they bought the house, they helped us buy a house, they helped us remodel it. Mm. There were 3 months of meals to the family, 3 months solid of meals. I can't mention things. The only ones that I want to mention are the ones that had to do with our kids, because that's what got through to my heart. Pastor Abe Miller was the youth pastor then, and he wouldn't probably want me to say anything, but he was amazing because he, you know, he welcomed our kids. I'm sure he probably said, "Now you welcome these kids, include these kids," you know, and I can just imagine that he did that. and then Marilyn Emmers. I told her I was going to tell people about this sometime. And she don't like people, you know, talking about her. She likes to point to the Lord. But she pointed my girls to Christ. Mm. And the way she did that was she took them to the Christian bookstore and bought Bibles for them. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't seem like a big deal, but it, as when I heard about it, I was like, wow. There's people that care about their souls and care about their hearts. And, you know, then I, just the other day, I was thinking, you know, I have, Jeannie's become a pastor's wife, John has become a pastor's wife. Who knows if, you know, I know that God's used all kinds of people, and I know that they are nothing like Marilyn is as far as a pastor's wife, but just the fact, I'm sure that they're just still reaching into, they use that example of how Marilyn is and how she reaches into the lives of other people. And it's not just my girls, she's done it. I've seen her doing it time and time again. And just amazing. I mean, those types of things that God has really used that have encouraged our hearts greatly. Mm. And it doesn't leave this building. Everybody here has been. There's a lot of people here that were a part. A lot of people that are that might listen that were a part of that. And they know who they are. And thank you very much.
Yeah, it's incredible. mm-hmm. Praise God. Mm-hmm. So, on a lighter note, just to give us a glimpse into how Bev is just an everyday woman, and you are a saint in so many eyes, but you have your human needs and your weaknesses, and you have your simple joys. So would you just share what are some activities that you like to do, whether as a hobby or just to relax, if you get much time, which you probably don't get much time, but if you do get a little window of time, how do you like to spend that time?
I love sports of any kind. I grew up playing softball, basketball, track, volleyball, whatever. I just love sports, games of any sort. I love any type of sports.
Are you competitive?
I'm kind of competitive, but not terribly. No, I think I'm a pretty good sport, usually.
Good.
Usually. Yeah. There are times when I'm like, you know, but most of the time I do okay on that. I just love to play. But now I'm older, so I can't really use that as my hobby. Mm. I love working in the yard.
Okay.
Absolutely love to garden. And during this time of the virus, I've done a lot of yard work, and I've loved it. It's like a therapy to me. So
yeah. What is something like just little and simple that brings you joy that maybe someone else would be like, really?
Well, I think I kind of said it, and that is, I do like to eat out with friends.
Okay.
I really like that. I like, you know, not a huge group. If you get too big, then I kind of feel out of place, but I like to eat out. I like to use it as a ministry, you know, too. I like to try to sharpen each other spiritually. If they're Christians, if they're unsaved, you can build a relationship, you know, and ultimately lead them to the Lord, of course. But so I do like to eat out, but I guess it's a farmer's thing, but I love to pull weeds.
Yeah.
I don't know why. It makes
it's kind of therapeutic. therapeutic.
It is.
A little bit.
It is. And I love it.
Yeah.
I don't mind it. I guess, yeah. You know, there's been times like, oh, this is way too much, you know.
Yeah.
But for the most, I do enjoy it. I like that.
Huh.
It is good.
Okay, so if you get to choose where you go out to eat and have that fellowship with friends, is there a kind of place you're going to choose? Or is there any one place?
Lately, we've been going to the Brazil Terra, or Terra, I guess you call it, Brazil Terra Grill in West Des Moines.
Okay.
And they serve Brazilian food.
Okay.
Which is amazing.
Okay.
They had another one downtown, and we went to that one with a few friends, but I think they're closed now.
Okay.
And the other one I think has kept going because they had carry out. Jared went and got it just not too long ago for us. So that would probably be my current favorite. John and I, we do a lot. Like when we're traveling, mm-hmm. we do a lot of fast food.
Yeah.
And we just grab whatever special is going on at McDonald's even. Or,
yeah.
or wherever, we just get a special. And
you're not too picky.
No.
No.
Not at all.
It's always nice not to have to cook a meal anyway.
Exactly. So. Exactly. Very true.
Okay. So... lastly, I just want to ask you, how can we as Saylorville women and anyone watching this, as Saylorville Church, be praying for you?
Okay. My main prayer request would be for the lost. I have a list of ladies that we're trying to reach in Brazil. I didn't bring that list. There's just a lot of them that the Lord has given me opportunity to, you know, be involved in their lives. I have a list and I try to pray for them daily. But the most recent one is Amy. She is Fick's wife, and Fick is the one that fixes John's wheelchair.
Okay.
And so John started, you know, talking to him about the Lord, and because John is a natural evangelist, he just does it with that. You know, if he's with somebody about 5 minutes, he'll just at least invite him to church. That's just John. It's a natural thing to him. I'm not so much that way. Mm. I'm much more reserved. I'm more like build a friendship and then give them the gospel. We just have two different methods. But John, you know, just kind of talked to Fick, and we mentioned that we were going to give our presentation here at the church. You know, we gave our report, and that there was going to be a Brazilian meal, and we invited them to come.
Okay.
Fick and Amy. We said, you know, bring your wife and girls. They have some kind of teenage daughter, probably about the age of your daughters.
Okay.
Anyway, they're like, sure. They accepted.
Wow.
You know, we were amazed. We're like, yes. So they were here that night. Not saved, and we just, you know, John needs to go out there quite often, so we keep talking to Fick. They're very strong Catholics, very. Their girls attend a Catholic school, and but just such sweet people, so sweet, and we've really enjoyed them. So, and you know, Amy, just recently, I don't remember when it was. It was either last week or the week before that she asked me for my friendship on Facebook. So I'm just trying to, you know, keep building a relationship with her gradually and praying. I know they loved it here at Saylorville. They loved the you know, the atmosphere and everything. So I'm praying for Amy. I'm praying for if you could pray for our travels begin this Sunday. We're going down to Missouri, and then the next Sunday we're going to Illinois, and then we're going to make a trip out east. And, you know, I've told my friends this too, that you can pray that I don't fall asleep, because I get tired at the wheel, and you know, sometimes I get sleepy, so you can pray that I don't fall asleep. Pray that God would really use this time. We're very burdened about people that there's a lack of missionaries, and there's so much to do in Brazil, so much to do worldwide, and John is really burdened to try to really emphasize that and get it, you know, get into the hearts of people. And so far he's used us a lot, but we've had this time off here and we're anxious to get back. But pray for our travels, our meetings. And then I have a personal prayer request. My mom is 87, and she's not doing very well. She's recently been diagnosed with dementia, and she's just kind of been going downhill. So you can pray for her and for wisdom in decisions that we need to make, our family.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, can I close us out by praying for you?
Sure. That'd be great.
Heavenly Father, I just thank you for how you work in individual lives. You call us down to individual paths, and it's just been a huge blessing to my heart to sit here with Bev and to get a glimpse into your calling for her and John in Brazil over these past almost 30 years, Lord. What a legacy that is, and I just thank you for that, and I just pray that you will continue to sustain their ministry in Brazil and continue to bless it, and that the ministry will be fruitful, and that while they're still here in America, that you will continue to be at work powerfully in Brazil in their absence, and just showing yourself faithful in John and Bev's absence. And I just pray for Bev's relationship with Amy and Vic and their girls, and Lord, you know the barriers that are around their hearts that are causing them to be hesitant and to cling to something that doesn't ultimately give them eternal life, Lord. So I just pray that you will open their eyes and that you will use John and Bev and their new friendship to just continue to point them to the truth, and that that truth will penetrate their hearts, Lord, sooner than later. And I'm sure there's an urgency there with them not sticking around here in America forever. So, Lord, would you just bring them to yourself in an urgent way, Lord? And I just pray for John and Bev's travels, and I know that it's a lot of work. It's a lot of responsibility. It's, I'm sure, exhausting and tiring and exhilarating and just all the things at once, Lord. So I just pray that you will go before them, that you will give them traveling mercies, that everything mechanically will be smooth, and that you will keep them healthy as they continue to be around a lot of people. Just protect their health, Lord, and just bless their time and their, especially John's desire to see more missionaries come to Brazil. Lord, if there is anyone listening or anyone that you know in their heart, they are thinking about missions and maybe thinking about Brazil, would you just be at work in their hearts and open the doors and bring confirmation and just give them a heart that is broken and burdened for Brazil, Lord, and just make that, just bring the workers down there, Lord. And I pray for Bev's mom, who is struggling with her health, and I'm sure it's so hard to watch and want to have control, but ultimately not having control, Lord. But you are the Lord over her mom's life and over her mind, and I just pray that you will be with her in all things and give Bev wisdom in how to love her mom the best right now. Just bless the Leonards, bless their incredible ministry, that they don't desire to get the glory. They want to point everyone to you, Lord, and I just pray that as a result, you will be glorified in a in an incredible way, Lord. So just bless them and thank you for your son who has just paved the way and has told us to go and tell the world about him, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.